Justin? Hello, we're going to get started. Encourage your friends to come in. Thank you for those who've already come in. Find a seat. I'm going to start with an announcement. Evidently, I've been told this, and I'm going to believe whoever told me, in fact, two or three people told me, that the provost has sent out an email saying that as of, I'm assuming the business day has already closed. So as a close of business, we can take off our masks. So let's celebrate that. All right, great. What a relief. All right, well, it is officially 6:30 and I'd like to get started. I want to welcome all of you to our first in-person event of this magnitude post-COVID. So we have a community here, and there are students and there are alums from many years. There are both MIP and IPS alums. And we have distinguished faculty that we're going to hear from very soon. So make yourself at home. This is a homecoming. I like to start with a little proverb, and this is just a quick montage to get us ready for the fireside chat. And the proverb is, may you live in interesting times. And so if we recall, on March 19th, shelter in place began. Here on campus, in-person classes stopped. Faculty went home, students had to leave campus. It was the worst of times. But you know, curiously, it was the best of times. One scene, I love sheltering in place. I sheltered in place very close by. What I really enjoyed was walking around and seeing their fathers babysitting their toddlers. And as a mother, I was a little critical, but the other thing that I realized is you had to look for best of times, and Thanksgiving that year was one that was remarkably warm and wistful. But then there were even worse times. And so the question becomes, and this is one, how do you manage in a VUCA world? Now, VUCA's been around for some time, and it was prescient. It was saying, you know, it was a foretelling. So what does it mean? It's volatile, it's uncertain, it's chaotic, it's ambiguous. Well, you get some MBAs, right? So I joined MIP July 27th, 2021. I'm a transplant, where we learned to change lives, change organizations, and change the world, generally for profit, and most often for maximization of shareholder value creation. So when I arrived, though, I began to compare and contrast the MBAs and the MIP students and immediately began to pick up on the differences. MIP students and MIP and IPS alums, you talked about wanting to do research and make policy. I had no idea what you were talking about. But it became clear to me that there was a whole host of pressing issues and challenges that compel you to action. So, a couple of questions. 2 months into this VUCA world, what is absorbing you? What is engaging you? When, how, and why do you invest your time, talent, and treasure? So, I've come to deeply respect this community of students, alumni, faculty, and researchers, particularly as I've witnessed your choices. You focus on producing leading exemplary research and real-world policy impact. Given the exclusivity of the MIP program, its size, and it allows close, meaningful, personal, and professional relationships to develop among the students and the faculty, the alums, and the researchers. And as students and alums, you decide on careers, really very different careers from some of the other schools. There's widening options and innovative ways that you define the impact you choose to make. So what some of you alums would be interested to know, each year the MIP program is attracting substantial increases in applications. Over the last 5 years, applications have grown 185%. Our admission rates puts us in the highly selective category for international affairs graduate programs. And again, quick montage. In terms of real-world policy impact, our students, this is one of my favorite students. She was the career representative for the International Policy Students Association. So here's how she spent her summer. Here's another one of our distinguished class of, hear little giggles here, the classmates are recognizing each other. But the EL spent time with the Oversight Board. And what has happened in the program that is making this possible? So I think one major factor is the Policy Change Studio, which is designed to give students really practical experience about affecting real change in the world. It's a two-quarter course. It's in which second-year students partner with organizations to tackle real-world problems. It's the capstone experience of the MIP program. And they're guided by an innovative problem-solving framework, which I discovered when I was an MBA. I thought this is like intellectual property and super duper useful. So more, this is a class. Stand up and take a bow if you're here. Yes, there we go. Here's another example, and there are many examples. And so another glance, things are happening on the employment front. Even with COVID and the disruption of the recruiting market and whatever else, our students still found ways to spend summer very productively. And if you'll notice, there's an increase in private sector, again, distinguishing us from many of the other schools, because of the emphasis, and I know Andy Grotto is here, on cyber policy. So the alums are just as active. Notice. Yeah. And here's also, this is where you really got a sense of community. And there's Chelsea here. And there was like, we ended up tracing alums, faculty members, students, at least 15, 20 working together to assist when Afghanistan fell. And finally, here's something over in the far corner, Robert Kuptis, co-founder and board observer. He founded Pure Harvest, which is a recognized leader in sustainable agriculture, growing year-round pesticide-free fresh fruits and vegetables in the Middle East. And if you check him out on Crunchbase, you'll be impressed. So since we like to think of branding over there at the business school, I decided to take a crack at version 1.0, which is only challenging you to come up with something very, very different. So here's how I see you when I have the conversations with you. But I also want to share with you, I have a sense that the Ford Dorsey Masters in International Policy Program exists for such a time as this. And as crisis follows crisis, this is and will be our community's finest hour. So now, I'd like to take you to February 24th, 2022. We are here to discuss what took place on that day. When I heard it, you know, my heart broke, and I just thought how important it is for us to come together and reflect and pray, if that's something that you do, or meditate. But the good news is we are here together, and our panel, if you got one of these, you'll see they're amazing bios on the back, so I'm not going to read through them. But I am going to introduce so that you can associate a name with this wonderful face. Frank Fukuyama, Stephen Pifer, and Rose Gottemoeller.
You got it.
Okay, good.
Okay. Yeah, so thanks very much, Mava, and thanks to all of the alums that have come back. It's great to see former students and people that have left the program. I really appreciated, you know, finding out what you guys are doing and the great things that you're doing. So thanks very much. you know, we hope to do these programs regularly so that you can all make connections between the different years. I'm particularly grateful to those that have been in the program, you know, 20 years ago, for taking the effort to be with us here today. So we are living in very interesting times, unfortunately. Here at FSI, we have had a lot of connections with Ukraine. In my center, the Center on Democracy Development and the Rule of Law, we actually run three different leadership programs that have targeted Ukrainians, including, I think, a lot of you that have been through the program in the last couple of years. Well, actually, because of COVID, it's longer than that, but in the last few years have met some of our Ukrainians that came in through the Ukrainian Emerging Leaders Program. But we have others like the Draper Hill Summer Fellows Program and the Leadership Academy for Development. And altogether, we probably got something like 150 Ukrainians that have been through different CDDRL programs over the last 7-8 years. And we've been in touch with a lot of them. We had our last big collective meeting, I think the day or two before the invasion. A lot of them were getting their children out of Kiev and into Lviv and other parts of Western Ukraine. You know, subsequently, you know, some of them have signed up for the territorial militia and are heading out to fight. They're all, you know, advocating and, you know, doing what they can both to protect their families and to, you know, to serve their country. And they've all said that it's been really remarkable that Ukraine is, you know, it was always a fractious place. Everybody loved complaining about their leadership and their president and corruption, but for the first time, they're really acting like a country with a degree of national unity. So that's heartening, but it's also a very tough situation. One of the big questions that has been raised by a lot of people is whether we're in a completely new era, because for the 30 years following the fall of the Berlin Wall, there's a large assumption, at least in Europe, that, you know, you wouldn't change borders by force, that large-scale war was really something of the past, and it's been a rude awakening to see that that's really not the case, and that there are countries and leaders out there that want to do that. And the question is, does that mark a general shift in global politics? Is this going to start happening in other parts of the world where major war between big powers is going to be possible? That's something I don't think we can answer at the moment, but that's certainly something in the back of my head as an issue to worry about. One of the encouraging things that I'm going to ask Rose about is the fact that so far the Western democracies have responded, you know, in a lot better than I expected. I think that the Biden administration, by the way, we're missing the State of the Union right now, so we'll have to read about it later, but so far the Biden administration has managed to organize things pretty well, I would say, in many respects, and the Western alliance has held together in a much more cohesive way, but the question is that, you know, a sea change that's going to stay with us for a while, or is that just a more momentary response? And then finally, the military situation on the ground. You know, Lincoln in his second inaugural says, you know, the progress of our arms upon which all else chiefly depends, you know, and that's really the chief theater in which things will be decided. And it's very mixed picture. And I think we've gone from incredible depression the first day of the invasion to the opposite, to kind of elation, because the Ukrainians were still there after 4 days or, you know, five, we're coming on 5 days, hadn't been defeated, seemed to be putting up a much stiffer resistance. The Russian army seemed to be much less competent, much more poorly led, and, you know, just outright incompetent. But I think that, you know, previous experience with military conflict teaches you that you can't judge the outcome of a war by what happens in the first week, and we're not even at a 1 week point yet. So I do think that we have to, you know, guard against these swings from excessive pessimism to excessive euphoria. And so maybe on that point, I want to start our little discussion by going to Rose first. And with your experience in NATO, one of the big issues is escalation. And you know, a lot of our Ukrainian friends have been calling for a no-fly zone over Ukraine, which has certain obvious dangers. I actually think that one of the escalatory paths lies that way, but there's also one in the Black Sea, because essentially the Russians have imposed a blockade on the southern ports of Ukraine, which are absolutely necessary to prevent the country from being strangled. That's an act of war. And you know, so there's going to be a lot of political pressure to help Ukraine, you know, to make sure Kiev doesn't fall, to make sure that they can continue to communicate with the outside world. So maybe you could talk a little bit about how you see the dangers. You spent your career, so by the way, Rose and I both started our careers at the RAND Corporation, so we've known each other, I know, more than 40, more than 40 years ago, yeah. And she's you know, like one of the leading experts on, you know, nuclear weapons and nuclear arms control. So, Rose, maybe you can just talk about what you see as the present dangers and, you know, some of the scenarios that may be in the future.
I'd like to come around to the nuclear question a bit later, but let me just talk about how I see the situation with NATO and the possibility of spillover and escalatory tensions there. And I do think it's interesting, on this no-fly zone question, it's interesting that the Russians haven't thrown much air power into this fight yet, and that I think when the Pentagon is considering what could be the next big wave, it is using air power. Even helicopters have not been used very much in this setting. I don't know, I haven't seen enough, and Steve, certainly you may want to comment on this too, seen enough to understand whether they just don't have their logistics train set to be able to support air operations over Ukraine, or what is deterring them from applying their air power in the skies above Ukraine. So at the moment, it's almost like they're deterred without a no-fly zone, but I'm not, again, counting on that staying for any period of time. I actually agree with our president and his military planners that it would be escalatory to impose a new no-fly zone over Ukraine, because our aircraft and NATO aircraft would be operating in Ukrainian airspace and would be encountering Russian jets in that space. Russian jets, presumably, that would be on the attack. So I do think that that is a very dangerous escalatory scenario, and I would not go there. The president has been resolved that we would not have American boots on the ground or NATO boots on the ground in Ukraine for the same reason, not to put in place escalatory risks that we do not want to contend with. The interesting thing, though, is that NATO is actually fairly well practiced in terms of preventing Russian incursions into airspace or the naval arena, sea territories of territorial waters of Ukraine over the past, and particularly since the 2014 seizure of Crimea. There has been a regularized air policing operation in the Baltic states with NATO fighter jets from all over the alliance. I mean, from, you know, Spain, Portugal, down south, from the from across the alliance coming, and really, it's been a very active, unfortunately, situation, because the Russians have been perpetrating regular attempts at incursions into NATO airspace. So they are now very well practiced at policing that airspace, escorting Russians who are Russian fighters that are intruding into the airspace out in a peaceful way, and also doing the same thing with naval incidents. So I actually feel that there's been a huge amount of training that's gone on over the past 8 years that will facilitate NATO's ability to avoid escalation from spillover into NATO waters and into NATO airspace. So I actually feel pretty good about that. But it is a danger. It will continue to be a danger. The other area that I was very worried about going into this crisis was the hybrid space, because NATO training and exercises, and especially when I was DSG, we did a major command exercise that looked at the implications of attacks in cyberspace for escalation and attempts to figure out when NATO needed to, you know, begin kinetic action. And it was very, very difficult to figure that out exactly. So NATO has worked very hard over the past, I would say again, probably since the invasion of Crimea, the work has intensified to figure out what to do about cyber attacks and misinformation campaigns perpetrated by the Russian Federation. And I was worried about that, but to my surprise, and we should probably talk about this some more, for one thing, NATO and NATO member states like the United States and UK seem to be winning the information war. And I think that's a really good thing, the way that we have gotten out ahead preemptively with information and driven the agenda in that arena much more than the Russians at this point. But the other thing that's going on that I can't quite get my head around yet is how we've been able to cope in cyberspace. Again, evidently in a rather uncoordinated way with some non-state actors participating, like these hacktivist groups. And yesterday I was hearing from some of our Ukrainian colleagues here that every young coder in Ukraine is trying to do everything they can to disrupt the Russians. So it's not only this like anonymous group, but apparently there's a lot of volunteers in Ukraine working this agenda as well. So there is something really important going on in terms of countering Russian cyber attacks. I can't quite get my head around it yet, exactly what's happening.
But I would assume also that the US has pretty substantial offensive cyber capabilities that are being held back because, you know, the first time you use them will be the last time you can use them. And I mean, something that we can't really talk very much about,
yeah.
but I would imagine that, you know, that's something that could happen in the future, could be triggered in the future.
It definitely could. And there's an official actual NATO policy that NATO member states can ask for. There's about a half dozen NATO states who have offered their so-called offensive cyber capabilities to a NATO member state that asked for them. I know of nobody who has asked for them so far, but I'm not sure that they couldn't be used in several settings if necessary.
Yeah. Steve, do you?
Yeah, no, a couple of comments. I mean, I think on the cyber capability, my guess is we do have very substantial offensive cyber capabilities, but they're probably being withheld as a deterrent to the Russians attacking American cyber systems. Now, I wouldn't exclude that maybe we've passed some tricks of the trade on to the Ukrainians, but my guess is we're not going to get involved in that way. Mm-hmm. But I would second what Rose said about the no-fly zone, because it's actually also not just being prepared to shoot down Russian planes, but because you want your planes carrying out the no-fly zone to be safe, you're going to have to take out air defenses. So are we prepared to go and do airstrikes against air defense systems, surface-to-air missile sites in Belarus and Russia?
Yeah, the Russians just said today they were going to put S-400s into Belarus, so there you go.
Yeah, so already, I mean, at that point you begin to say, well, what is the difference between that kind of campaign and a full-out shooting war? And that's where I think the President and NATO have been right to draw that line and say, look, we will provide Ukrainians with weapons, we'll provide political support, we'll sanction the heck out of the Russians. But we're not going to put American and NATO boots on the ground. And in a way, I think that's perhaps even a little bit better for Ukraine, even though most Ukrainians would probably disagree, is that right now there's a conflict between Russia and Ukraine. We don't yet know what Putin's objective is. I think it's fairly obvious that he wants to take down the government of Kyiv and try to put in a pro-Russian government, which means he's going to have to occupy a good chunk of the country for some time to come. But he could change that. And the second objective that was sort of discussed a week ago was, well, maybe he just wants to go in and trash the Ukrainian military, because one of his goals is demilitarization. If he decided things were too difficult now, you know, he could declare victory and leave. He said, I've destroyed enough, I've taught them a lesson, he could leave, declare victory. And because of the ability of the Kremlin to control the information space towards most Russians, they could portray it as a victory. I think if the Americans and NATO went in, though, that conflict changes fundamentally in its character. That confirms in Putin's mind all of the worst paranoid fantasies he's had about the West being out to get him. And then I think that fight becomes existential in a way that it's not now. And that's where I would really begin to worry about things like, you know, how far does it go? Does he feel like we're pushing him to a corner where if he's losing, you know, then he has to escalate to nuclear weapons.
Yeah.
So I think again, most Ukrainians, I think, would feel, well, that's kind of a cop-out for the West. But I think in a way, you know, our involvement would actually make it harder on Ukraine because Ukraine would be the battlefield.
Yeah. Well, so I was going to ask you what kind of future political scenarios you could imagine either side settling for. I mean, I don't think anyone was surprised that these negotiations that took place yesterday didn't lead anywhere, because we're just not at that point. So I don't know if you noticed this, but the Russians actually mistakenly published this article that was supposed to be a celebration of their victory.
Right.
And they said, you know, we're now entering a new world order in which the mistake, the tragedy of 1991, which was the breakup of the Soviet Union, has been reversed, and Belarus, Ukraine, and Russia are all part of the same country now. And they said, oops.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, yeah.
But this actually, I mean, this is one of the things that worries me about the Kremlin, is I think in the Kremlin, they fundamentally don't understand Ukraine. About 10 or 11 years ago, when I was in Moscow, I was at a dinner at the American ambassador's residence, and we had a very senior retired foreign policy guy there. And I asked him, I said, does anybody in the Kremlin really understand Ukraine? And he thought for a moment, yeah, there's one guy who really understands Ukraine very, very well. And then he said, but nobody listens to him. And I think it's obvious. I mean, Vladimir Putin, the last time he was in Kyiv was in 2013. And this was to mark the 1,025th anniversary of Kyiv and Rus. And that's the founding state for both Ukraine and Russia. In Russia, they say that Kyiv is the mother of all Russian cities. But he was there to mark the 1,025th anniversary of Kyiv and Rus' acceptance of Christianity, which of course had huge implications for religion in both countries. But he gives this speech, and one of the big themes is, we are one people. And he repeats that. And for a lot, I mean, that's just a totally tone-deaf thing to say in Ukraine. Because for a large portion of the ethnic Ukrainians, what they hear is, you've denied my language, my culture, my history. And so I think there's this very big misconception. I think we're seeing this perhaps in the execution so far of the Russian military campaign is, you know, again, I can't read the minds of the general staff or the Kremlin, but I think that they really thought that, one, the Ukrainian military would fold in a heartbeat, and that they really would be greeted by as liberators. And they've been, I think, quite shocked by the fierceness of the resistance. And I think one of the things you're seeing now and why we shouldn't be too elated. I mean, it's good what the Ukrainians have done, but there's still a lot of force the Russians can bring to bear, and they may now be organizing to do that. And what I worry about is that they revert to tactics that, you know, they displayed, for example, in Grozny during the Chechen wars, and we'll have to watch that.
Yeah, and they seem to be starting that in Kharkiv.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's, they're running out of PGMs, and so they're just going to use dumb bombs and artillery and grads and all of the things that kill a lot of civilians without a lot of discrimination.
Yeah.
Or the thermobaric bombs that they used in Chechnya as well, which were, and Syria, which were hugely destructive.
Yeah. But so what kinds of political settlements could you imagine? The scenario where Putin just declares victory and gets out doesn't seem...
Small chance.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty small. If he really does think that, you know, his goal was to actually unify, you know, these three Slavic nations. And even if he wanted to do that, what do you do about the Donbass? Because you've all of a sudden, declared them as independent republics. Ukraine will never accept that, right?
Well, that's an interesting question. I mean, because I actually had a conversation with a senior Ukrainian official. This was like 6 or 7 years ago. And he said, maybe it is time for us to let the Donbass go. He goes, that's after Crimea, that's the part of Ukraine that they don't really think about us. Politically, it makes politics in the Ukraine a lot easier because the what used to be the opposition bloc, the party that supported Yanukovych, that's where his power base was.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, one of the odd things is by the Russian seizure and annexation of Crimea and then the breakaway of Donbass, they've removed probably about 4 million voters from the Ukrainian electoral rolls who would likely be voting for the party most sympathetic for the Russians.
Mm-hmm.
But the person who said it, he says, you know, maybe it's time, he said, but the problem is it's going to be a long time before a political leader can say that and have that be accepted politically within Ukraine.
Yeah. And especially after this Russian aggression, it will be seen as rewarding Russia for having done that. And that's very implausible. So Rose, I think one of the biggest revolutions has been in German foreign policy. Germans announcing, you know, doubling of their defense budget and their willingness to sell weapons or ship weapons to Ukraine and other places under attack. What do you make of this, and how permanent do you think this is? That's one respect in which it does seem to me there really is a sea change that, you know, puts us in a very different era.
Well, Angela Merkel and the Germans stood up to Donald Trump when he was browbeating them endlessly while he was president of the United States. And you all know how difficult it was for NATO during that period. Now, NATO countries have made the so-called defense investment pledge at the Wales summit in 2014, after the Russians seized Crimea, to spend 2% of their GDP by 2024 on the defense budget, on their military. And the Germans, throughout that incredibly difficult period with Donald Trump, just stood firm and said, no, we cannot do it. It would make the German army too huge, because their GDP is the huge one in Europe. It would make the German armed forces too huge, and therefore there would be people nervous because they will remember World War II. I thought this was really a dodge at the time, because you can look and see how the German armed forces were not up to snuff. They're still fighting over what they're going to do about modernizing their Tornados, their aircraft capable of the nuclear mission, the dual capable mission. And a lot of their capability was not very ready, and continues to be the case. So they did not place it as a high priority. That was the point. They were willing, and Merkel did a lot to ramp up defense spending during her time in office. Ursula von der Leyen, who's now at the European Union leadership, did a lot, but they were like at 1.3, and they weren't coming up to 2%. They were just not coming up to 2%. And so for me, this is an enormous sea change. And I think it's gonna stick. Once they start spending that amount, I don't see them falling back very easily, because it helps actually that we've now moved on to a new Chancellor Scholz, and the government has changed overall. There's a lot of, I think, soul searching going on in Berlin right now about where Germany is headed and what it can do now. By the way, did you see that the entire staff
Gerhard Schroeder's
of
staff.
Schroeder's, yes, just left, because, you know, he's the fellow who just went onto the Gazprom board and apparently is continuing to support Putin and support Nord Stream 2, etc. But his entire staff walked out today. So there's a real sea change going on in Germany, and I don't see them reverting, Frank, mm-hmm. to be honest. But so you just spent a whole 6 months there,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, no, it was interesting. I think what you've seen is, you know, for five decades, Germany, I mean, it goes back to the late 60s, Germany pursued this this policy, in part, I think, motivated by war guilt, but this policy, this relationship with Russia. And I think in like the last 7 days, we've seen that 5 decades just wiped away. I mean, it was just sort of stunning. You know, on Tuesday, they killed Nord Stream. You know, on Thursday, they prepared to kick the Russians out of SWIFT. Saturday, they junk this policy. They've had this policy for years. They will not provide weapons to a conflict zone, and they say, nope, we're gonna start sending Stingers and anti-tank weapons. And then the huge defense posts up on Sunday. It's kind of like, what's gonna happen, you know, on tomorrow? but it really, I think it's interesting looking at this campaign. I mean, my guess is that usually surprised the Kremlin. I think this has been surprise after
they
surprise.
They thought the stoplight coalition was going to be weak and dividable, that they could exert leverage.
Yeah, but just the unity of NATO in response, the U.S., the sanctions. I mean, I don't think they anticipated these sanctions. Everyone had been talking about SWIFT, which to some extent I think became a symbol and may have been more than it really meant. But the real thing was hitting the central bank. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Russia has, what, $600 billion in foreign currency reserves. Well, 70% of those are in Western banks are now frozen. And as I understand, a lot of the revenues that they get paid into that bank. But if you have money being paid into your account and you can't spend it, what good is it? Mm-hmm. So I think there's just, just sort of, if you do the kind of the pluses and minus board, right now it's pretty negative. Mm-hmm. Finland and Sweden. So there was a NATO virtual summit on Friday. Mm-hmm. NATO leaders and the Finns and the Swedes. There was a poll that came out yesterday that showed 53% of Finns now believe their country should be in NATO. That poll was taken on Wednesday, the day before the Russians attacked Ukraine, so one wonders what that percentage is like now.
Right.
The Russians are rolling up victory after victory here, I think, with their foreign policy.
What would it, and what's the formal procedure for admitting them? How long would that take?
Well, it's they have to first ask, to join, and then they would go through a review process, and there would be some tasks set out for them. Oftentimes those tasks can be stretched out, as in the case of Ukraine and its aspirant status in NATO, but I have a feeling in the case of Sweden and Finland, there would be, you know, there would be little rationale to stretch out the tasks because they are already very well-trained militaries.
If North Macedonia can make it, I think Finland can make it.
They have civilian control of the military, all that kind of thing.
Established democracy.
Established democracy. Their security services are under civilian control as well. So I don't think there would be any reason to stretch out their membership request. I just want to say, by the way, because people ask me this question all the time, why couldn't NATO, come to Ukraine and say you're in? Like, as it was leading up to this crisis, I was getting this question a lot. And honestly speaking, there was still a lot of heavy lifting to be done in Kyiv to deal with corruption, for example, and to ensure that they have proper civilian oversight, not only of the military. They've done a good job in recent years putting in place a civilian defense minister and structures in the Ministry of Defense. The security services, still with many links to the KGB or the Russians, the Russian security services, making sure that they are under proper governance, under proper civilian control. So there were still many tasks that the Ukrainians had on their plate before they'd be ready for NATO membership.
By the way, I didn't mean to make fun of North Macedonia. I'm heading there on Saturday.
I know, and they're the best, too.
But they're actually, they've got a decent government. I mean, I would say Montenegro is a little bit, shakier in that respect.
Right, I agree.
So let's talk about another NATO member, Turkey. So I've been kind of focused on the Black Sea because it's extremely important to Ukraine. Now, Ukraine is a major agricultural exporter. There was an article in the Times yesterday, I believe, about how Tunisia and Egypt have seen these sudden massive increases in the price of bread because, they get their wheat from Ukraine and they're not getting it.
Wheat futures are going up very fast.
And it seems to me that everybody is so focused on Kyiv that they are not paying attention to the, I think, bigger successes that the Russians are having in Kherson and moving in on Odessa and slowly choking off Ukraine's ability to have access to the Black Sea. But Turkey has played a really interesting role, in my view. So if you've been watching these TB2 drones, they've been just deadly for Russian armor. Those are all coming from Turkey. They're co-manufactured. They have Ukrainian engines, a lot of them in them. So this defense cooperation has been going on, and the Turks just announced closing the straits under the Montreux Convention I guess they had to be even-handed to all combatant ships, but that really affects the Russians much more than the Ukrainians. How do you see that playing out, either one of you?
Well, I will just say, I think Erdogan actually thought that his relationship with Putin would help in the run-up to the crisis, and I think he tried. And I think he was pretty angry afterwards that it didn't pay off. So I'm interested still to see whether there's any particular role that Erdogan himself could play, perhaps, in trying to ameliorates or mitigates some of the worst ravages of this crisis, but I'm not sure about that. I agree with you, Frank, that it's been very interesting how Turkey has stepped up to the plate in recent days. It was resisting closing the straits and saying the Montreux Convention does not really allow for that. Warships need to be able to return to their bases, et cetera, et cetera. But they have really, really stepped up now. The interesting thing, this is a more of a general comment, everybody's talking about how the NATO alliance is being brought back together by having to respond in a coherent way to this invasion. But it's also really bringing the bad boys back to the table in a really coherent way. Erdogan's a great example. He's been the nightmare bad boy now, buying the S-400. I just mentioned the S-400 in Belarus, but buying the S-400 after the coup that affected him in 2017, and then getting thrown out of the F-35 program because the fighter program, because that S-400 would illuminate the F-35 and learn too much about it if it should operate in Turkish airspace. So that was a big issue while I was NATO DSG, and it really led to a lot of stresses and strains between NATO headquarters and Ankara, as well as between Ankara and Washington. Other bad boys, Poland and Hungary. Hungary was fighting with Ukraine over the Ukrainian minorities in Hungary and really stopping meetings of the NATO-Ukraine Council and not allowing us to meet officially with the Ukrainians. Now, Hungary is welcoming across the border people fleeing from Ukraine. Probably they're taking the Ukrainians first, Ukrainian-Hungarians first, right. But nevertheless, they are welcoming, and that for the Prime Minister of Hungary, Orban, is a big deal anyway to be taking immigrants in. The same in Poland. Poland resisted immigration in Europe and now has opened its doors. So the bad boys of NATO have come around the table and are really playing, I think, quite a positive role. That's something I'm not sure will last. There's always going to be frictions inside NATO between and among various members. But at the moment, they have, I think, atoned for their sins from the perspective of NATO leadership.
Yeah. Steve, do you?
I think on Turkey, it's been interesting. I think Turkey has tried to cultivate this relationship with Moscow. Mm-hmm. But they have never sacrificed Ukrainian interests. I mean, Turkey still adamantly pursues a policy of non-recognition with regards to Crimea's illegal annexation
That's
by the Russians.
That's a good point.
And as you mentioned, they're providing these drones. They're providing the Ukrainians weapons, which are proving highly effective. And I think are making a lot of Russian soldiers nervous right now.
Yeah. Okay, I want to open this up for broader discussion. Maybe one last thing we could talk about is, you know, the kind of global shift. So Russia is basically being closed out. It's being treated like North Korea in a certain way. It's really being frozen out of Western financial markets. There's basically only one place they can run to, which is China,
cryptocurrency.
Yeah. some combination of the renminbi and cryptocurrencies. Global energy markets are shifting. I mean, I think one of the things that was very good that the Biden administration did was to try to redirect as much LNG as possible away from Asia and towards Europe so that the Europeans could get through the winter. You know, I mean, the Russians have never failed to use gas as a weapon. Why anybody would want to buy gas from them is really beyond me, but
Let me just agree. I think the Russian practice in Europe was, if you were a former Soviet state or the Baltic states, yeah, they used gas as a weapon a lot in the last 30 years. But they've tried to maintain the image and the reality of being a reliable gas supplier to like Germany, Austria, the Netherlands, and Italy. What's been different this year is, you know, what they say now is that they are meeting their contract obligations. And I think it's actually Gazprom is meeting obligations to provide gas under long-term contracts. What Gazprom is not doing, despite the fact that there are sky-high prices for gas, is they're doing nothing on the spot market.
Yeah.
And that's one of the ways why, I mean—
And that drives the prices up and—
Even further, yeah. So they're playing a game here while saying, you know, hey, we're meeting our obligations. Mm. You know, but they have, I think, for this is like the first time, I think, where they've really demonstrated a use of the gas as a weapon against Germany, things like that. And my guess is you're going to see these countries now being looking at more LNG facilities, probably in Germany, an acceleration of the effort to move towards renewables and get off gas.
Mm-hmm.
And this will be, I think, a long-term problem for Russia, because if you look at their export structure, I think the last time, like 70% of their exports are oil, gas, and other things that come out of the ground.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The gas that goes to Europe cannot easily be swung to Asia, because they're really sort of two different systems. The gas that goes to China comes out of different fields in Siberia. And you got to build about a 2,000 kilometer pipeline to swing that. So there's kind of a captive market there, and the Russians are running the risk of losing it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, another interesting little fact I heard driving over here is they were talking about the price now on the oil market, and Ural crude is the standard, the Russian standard. It's being heavily discounted by the Russians. Price of oil today was up to, for Brent, was up to $118 a barrel or something like that. They said that the Russians are discounting by $18 to $20 their Ural crude, but there are no takers. So the sanctions regime and the kind of pariah status descending on Russia is also apparently affecting their ability to sell their oil,
And I think
even at a heavily discounted rate.
Yeah. And I think there was a hope. I mean, in 2014, when the first sanctions began to be applied on Russia, I think there was a hope in Russia, well, we can switch to China and the Chinese will pick up the slack.
Mm-hmm.
Because one of the things that the West did shut off was a lot of financing for Russian companies. And they went to Chinese banks, and the Chinese banks were very reluctant. It was a combination of two things. One is, they looked at some of the Russian enterprises and said, well, we're not quite sure that's really a worthwhile investment. But also there was this concern that if they got too close to Russian companies, they might then fall under Western sanctions.
Mm-hmm.
So I think any Russian hopes now that China will somehow save them, particularly given the scope and the size of the Chinese economic relationship with the West, mm-hmm. which they don't want to endanger, I think the Russians will be disappointed again.
Yeah.
So they're left with cryptocurrency.
Yeah.
Do you think there's a little bit of a danger of, you know, kind of anti-Russianism kind of running wild, like mm-hmm. the Münchner Philharmonic just kicked Anna Netrebko off their payroll in Grigori, I mean, Russian students, you know, in Western universities. And
yeah, that's true. Yeah. You know, and there was some frustration on Twitter today, which I thought was I think it's a warning to us all, academics in Russia and scientists who engage in cooperation getting kicked off, you know, grants and stuff like that. And they're saying, hey, we're the good guys. We're trying to raise our voices here. Why are we suddenly just getting kicked automatically off our cooperative grants? So I think we all need to bear that in mind.
Okay, well, why don't we open this up for anybody in the audience that has a question. There's a microphone there, and if you want to ask a question, just come up and identify yourself. Dathan, go ahead.
Hi, panelists. It's great to see everyone. I'm really happy to be back here and see everyone. My main question has to do with the Federated Mission Network. The Federated Mission Network annually is set up by NATO to create network interoperability between NATO and NATO partners through Operation Steadfast Cobalt. Every year the network is set up, we try to make it work, then we tear it down, and then next year we do it all over again. Is now the time that NATO should be bringing in partners, given the amount of time horizon to get this network connected and up and running? Should we be reaching out to our partners, reaching out to our allies and the people that have used this network in the past to get it operational, just in case? Is now the time for that? Thank you.
Probably the answer is yes, but I don't really know enough about the issue. I have to be honest with you. And I'll be honest with you also that NATO headquarters is gripped now with dealing with this crisis. So I'm finding that what would be normal policy cycles inside NATO are getting preempted now by the necessity of responding to the crisis. So it's a very good question, but I'm not sure how much bandwidth NATO is going to have for engaging in what would be important but more or less normal business.
Hi there, my name is Elliot. I'm a first-year MBA student, though not concerned with shareholders today. In recent days, we've seen NATO members make escalating pledges of weapons and materiel, including fighter jets, anti-tank weapons, javelins. I'm curious about two things. One, if the Ukrainian armed forces are ready and able to receive those weapons, if they'll make a difference. And two, if those will have any escalatory potential as they're delivered by presumably NATO members.
Right. They are strictly defensive weapons by NATO's definitions. And of course, the Russians don't agree with that. And so they could consider them escalatory, quote unquote. But the javelins and the stingers, they're basically used in anti-tank kinds of applications. I frankly don't know what's going to happen in terms of you know, things like fighter jets being provided. That's something else indeed. I will say that the Ukrainians have been training hard on javelins and stingers now over a number of years. There was resistance in the USG back in 2014. I was the Undersecretary of State for Arms Control at that time.
That's right.
Oddly,
you were, weren't you?
Also responsible for signing off on weapons sales and weapons donations to various countries. It was a huge fight inside the Obama administration, and we said no. to sending those kinds of defensive weapon systems to Ukraine in 2014. I was against it. I lost. Now, I'm happy to say, it was in the Trump administration, they started sending defensive weapons of this kind to Ukraine. And so there's been a good training experience over the last couple of years for these systems that have gone in. The other thing I like to point out is it's not only the higher end things like the Javelins, but also ammo. All of the NATO countries, well, not all of them, but a lot of them now are participating in getting ammunition into Ukraine. And the good thing is NATO learned its lesson well in Libya, that it could not have every country having its own, you know, ammunition for various calibers of weapon systems or guns and so forth. They said, we have to have common standards. We have to have common ammunition, and that is extended to the partners like Ukraine as well in the way that ammunition is moving around NATO and between NATO and its partners. So I feel good about that. That was a kind of behind-the-scenes quiet project that really drove greater effectiveness inside NATO, and again, a lesson learned from the Libya experience.
I'd make two observations. I was actually part of a group that in 2015 lobbied the U.S. government to provide anti-armor missiles.
You had our job.
Yeah. Well, no. Actually, I would say that based on, we met a lot of people in the U.S. government, and I think we had pretty much everybody persuaded except one person.
The one important person.
And that
person.
One person lived in the White House, so that was, he had the final vote.
He has a big office that's shaped like this.
Yeah, yeah. But it was interesting because I think the concern was, I think this was an understandable concern, but you know, what the National Security Advisor told us, the concern was, will the Russians escalate? And what happened when the Trump administration, you know, one of the few things I will give the president credit for is they did authorize the provision of Javelins, and the Russians kind of accepted it. So I think below a certain level, I'm sure the Russians don't like it, but they seem to kind of understand that this is part of the game.
Good evening. I'm one of the old IPS guys from 93, and like Maeve, I was a GSB and a JD grad as well. So it's great to see you having these organizations to mix the younger and the older crowd together to learn from each other. I've got a maybe politically incorrect question for you guys. I was Turkish track, spent decades in Turkey and the Middle East. To what extent, and I don't hear any comment today, is NATO not egging on this process? I didn't hear any mention of missiles in Poland that are pointing directly at Moscow, 100 years away from it. I didn't hear any mention of the fact that Ukraine has not paid its own oil bill to Kiev and has been stealing for decades. Is in fact Putin that when we hear and we in the West worry about Russia buying Facebook ads to upset our campaign, we really have done our fair share as well to disrupt Ukraine with the Orange Revolution and the color revolutions on their border. Is that completely out of the thought pattern, or is that just not part of the thinking?
Can I object first?
Yeah, go ahead.
No, let me just disagree. I mean, there is a narrative out there that says the Orange Revolution was orchestrated by the CIA and MI6, and quite frankly, that's total bullshit. We did not have the capabilities. I mean, I left the government in 2004 before this happened. But looking towards the election that triggered the Orange Revolution, I sat down, I was the Deputy Assistant Secretary responsible for Russia and Ukraine at the time. I sat down with our ambassador from there and our assistants, and we went through every dollar we were spending on elections. And the question was, is this money that goes to process and not one way or the other? And we were pretty much convinced. I mean, we could show it to the Russians and say, look, election monitors, that shouldn't be a political issue. You know, journalists covering elections, that shouldn't be a political issue. International observers, there's simply no evidence that I've seen that the United States prompted this. This was a stolen election. I can go through you hour by hour how it was stolen. And a whole bunch of Ukrainians said, we're not going to let this happen. The Maidan Revolution was triggered, by the European, over the European Union, is President Yanukovych had negotiated, and to his credit, actually had done the homework to conclude an association agreement with the EU. It was going to be signed at an EU-Ukraine summit in November of 2013. A week before that summit, he says, we've decided to pull the trigger on that. And one of the graduates of Frank's program got on his, Ivan, this is a Ukrainian, and says, this is outrageous, let's meet down on the Maidan to protest, and like 10,000 people show up. And then it grew. The Ukrainians then made the mistake of using force, breaking up and putting about 50 kids in the hospital. The next day, like 500,000 people showed up. I wish we had the capability to mobilize people like that. We don't. So I think that's the first, I would just agree with the premise of your argument. Do you want to take on the NATO part?
Well, I'm just going to say about missiles pointed at Russia, you know, in the heart of NATO is a place called Kaliningrad, where for years the Russians have been deploying very capable new missiles, the Iskanders, the very capable family of missiles, but also more recently the so-called 9M729, which is an intermediate range ground launch system that is now ranging all of NATO Europe. So there are missiles pointed in both directions, and that leads to, we hope, a stable deterrent force. But I actually hope someday we can get back to the negotiating table and get those intermediate range missiles out of Europe again.
Yeah, that's interesting. So Kaliningrad is the balancing point, we're thinking, for the reason we're putting the missiles in Poland.
No. What you have in Romania and Poland are missile interceptors, SM-3s, that are designed to intercept incoming missiles. Now, the problem here is, and actually I am sympathetic to the Russian concern about this, because for economic reasons, the launchers that are sitting in Romania and are now about to be built in Poland, it's called the Mark 41. Those launchers are also on most every U.S. warship. And on a U.S. warship, it can carry not just a missile interceptor, but it can carry a sea-launched cruise missile. And that's what Putin's expressed concern about. Well, a month ago, in response to some Russian proposals, the U.S. government said, look, you know, you're concerned about this. We will allow you to come and inspect those sites. You can look inside and you can verify for your own, be content. These are SM-3 interceptors. They are not cruise missiles. Now, they said, we would like to go then and look at a couple of your bases about which we have control. The Russians just, you know, blew all those ideas off.
Okay, we got
Thank
a
you for your
line
assistance.
Of people,
I appreciate
so,
your
yeah.
time today.
Let's try to keep our questions brief and answers too.
Okay.
Hi there, I'm also a member of the Old Guard Class of 2000 IPS, and just so thrilled to our first welcoming home. I have two very quick questions. One is that it seems that you all are incredibly calm up there discussing your responses, and I just really wanted to know, is that how you're feeling inside? And, you know, at this time, I just, please tell us, is this unprecedented? How are you feeling and dealing with this, especially given your experience? And then my other question is just to clarify, with Ukraine and NATO, are we trying to tighten that long process to get them in? Will Putin see that as an escalation? Should we or will we admit Ukraine to NATO?
Maybe I'll start. All I have to say is, I went like this. You know that painting. I do feel worried and very concerned. I think this nuclear saber rattling is unwarranted and egregious, but Putin, his rationality does not seem to be what it should be in this circumstance. And if you have any doubts of that, watch that speech he gave last Monday on Russian television. So I am worried, but we have to keep, what do the Brits say, keep calm and soldier on, or carry on. As far as Ukraine's membership in NATO, from NATO's perspective, its membership is still very much on the table. It's an aspirant to NATO, and it's up to Ukraine to decide to do otherwise. So we'll see these negotiations going forward with the Russians. They may decide to change their mind. But at the moment, from NATO's perspective, they are NATO aspirants.
Yeah, I think I'd say I'm about where Rose is, a little bit nervous. In part because I look at Vladimir Putin, we're not dealing with the same Vladimir Putin that we were dealing with, say, 15 years ago. I think we're somebody who has become in an inner circle for a long time, so he's getting, I think, limited channels of information. So my guess is his, instead of having a view like this, it's much narrower. He seems to be, I don't want to say paranoid, but his concern about COVID is bizarre. For the last 2 years, he's been extremely isolated, and you see these pictures. I mean, I assume that to go and meet the president of Russia now, the Minister of Defense and the Chief of the General Staff have been vaccinated. He sits at one of the table, and they're like literally 25 feet down the table. That's weird, I'm sorry. He also strikes me as somebody who I think used to be pretty calculated. He would look at the pluses and the minuses, and he would make pretty rational decisions. I mean, there was a logic there. We may not have always understood it, but there was a logic. I think particularly with regards to Ukraine, he's become much more emotional now. And I guess the last point I'd say is, he was a person who I think would take calculated risks when the risks were manageable. The risk he's taking on now, I think, is huge, both in terms of the fight with Ukraine, but also what it could mean for public opinion back home, particularly if there are, when the word gets out that there are lots of Russian soldiers dying in Ukraine now. I guess the only comment I would make on Ukraine and NATO is, I've been a supporter of Ukraine's NATO ambitions for a long time, but I think there is a reality here, which is as long as the Russians occupy Crimea and part of Donbas, and until Ukraine may never want to do this, unless Ukraine renounces those territories, that's probably a de facto veto, in the sense that it raises the question, if we brought NATO into the alliance tomorrow on Wednesday, with Russian forces occupying part of Ukraine, or Ukraine into NATO, does that mean on Thursday that NATO has an Article 5 contingency and has to go to war against Russia? So I think that's a problem there, and I'm not sure how we figure out how to get around that one.
So it's 7:30 now. Steve?
A few minutes and I have to read.
Yeah, okay. What, maybe the three remaining people, you can ask your questions sequentially, and then you two can answer them, as a group. So.
Sure. I had two, but I'm happy to have you choose whichever you prefer. The first one has to do with EU defense in this situation. We've seen Germany change its policy stance. President Macron has always been a proponent of united EU defense. As the stakes between the US and the EU in EU countries might seem slightly perhaps asymmetric and may drift further apart as the immediate threat becomes more obvious to European neighbors than it would be to America. How do you expect this situation to impact incentives for a united EU defense, and what reactions does that trigger in US officials? Is that something that's being talked about in Washington at all? And then the second point is, there's been talks that the Zelensky government reached out to China to possibly host the next round of negotiations. Do we think China hosting these talks might provide Putin with an off-ramp? And if so, of what kind?
Okay, let's have the next two questions.
Thank you so much for your remarks. I was wondering if you think that it's wise for NATO to publicly draw a red line for military intervention, either Russian actions in Ukraine or outside of Ukraine, and what should that red line be? Thank you.
Thank you all for putting on this talk. I was wondering if you could expand on something that Steve started to get into, which is the likely domestic political fallout and implications of this choice to go to war in Ukraine for President Putin, especially amongst the senior members of bureaucracy, military, the political class, and the business class. Thank you.
Okay, so you can reply to any of
you go first, and then you can run away.
I'll take that question and the Zelensky question. I think where you're seeing most evident right now is the reaction in Russia is just among the public. I mean, sort of the anecdotes are Russians who hear about this, and bear in mind they're getting a very narrow story. What they're told is that the military operations are around Donbas. They are not told that there's a large Russian column about to besiege Kyiv. They are told that the press outlets cannot use the word war or invasion. And in fact, one is getting, I forget when.
It's a peacekeeping mission, right?
Well, but actually, they're actually shutting down aid outlets for using.
Echo Moskvy is shut down.
Shut down, right? Because it called it an invasion. And it was only on Sunday, so on day four of the conflict, that the Ministry of Defense said, yes, there have been some casualties. But I think as the word gets out, there's going to be a lot of questions among Russians, why are we going to war against Ukrainians? Putin's told them we're all one people. Why are we doing this? The Ukrainians, I think, are very smart at info operations. They may be playing a little bit loose with rules regarding how do you treat prisoners. but they've been, when they capture Russian prisoners, they say, here's a cell phone, call your mom and tell her where you are. And it's a way to get that information out. Russian soldiers are getting captured. Oh, and by the way, tell them about your six buddies who aren't here because they were in the APC that ended up with a javelin. And so I think as that information gets out, there's going to be this unrest from below. Now, we don't know how the Russian public reacts. I mean, they've been pretty accepting of a fairly authoritarian system. They haven't pushed back much. But does this begin to trigger it, particularly when they begin to see more casualties? So I think that's the unknown. And then how does the Kremlin react to that? And then how do people around Putin feel, because this has really been kind of Putin's war. I mean, one of the real interesting things is the staging of his Russian Security Council meeting last Monday. He's sitting at a desk here, and 30 feet away are arrayed his 20 advisors, but it was pretty much, I'm Vladimir Putin, I'm the one who made this decision. And at some point, maybe that comes back to bite him. On the question on Zelensky and China, I had not seen that Zelensky had reached out to ask the Chinese to be an intermediary. I think it's an interesting question because my guess is the Chinese are getting more and more unsettled by this. Mm-hmm. Putin, he's launched a war. I mean, first of all, there's no way China can recognize these two breakaway republics because that immediately compromises their position on Taiwan. The nuclear threat, I'm sure, is not going down well in Beijing. Beijing might not be a bad spot to hold the next round of talks. But I think tomorrow they're meeting either in Belarus again or maybe on the Polish-Belarus border. There's some site. But again, my guess is that for any negotiations, whoever is the intermediary, the sides are still probably too far apart. I mean, if the Russian mm-hmm. position is we want to come in and depose the government and replace you, it's kind of hard to see the Zelensky government saying, okay, that sounds like a reasonable compromise. So with apologies, I need to help.
Okay.
Yes.
Go ahead, Steve.
Maybe I'll start on the EU question, which was a very, very good question. Oh, did you want to say some remarks?
Unfortunately, Steve has to leave.
Let's have Rose answer that question.
Well, I was saying we could still talk for another 5 or 10 minutes, if you like.
Yes.
After Steve leaves.
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay. But then...
So I'll just quickly go through the EU question and the red line question. I do think also that this crisis has really driven the EU together, but it's interestingly, and there's always, this has been this tension, NATO, it's the security organization and defense organization. Macron wants EU to be more autonomous with its defense capabilities, and always the subtext was, and drift away from NATO. Actually, Jens Stoltenberg and I never felt that way. He was my boss, of course, the Secretary General. We always said that if EU built up autonomous capabilities and made them available for NATO operations, there should be no contradiction. Also, as long as the requirements processes in the EU and NATO did not contradict each other, there should be no problem. So we were always very supportive of this kind of cooperation, but there was always that sense that, and this kind of friction. But now what I think is happening, and I see happening, is it's not only that NATO and the EU, the countries are being driven into closer cooperation among themselves, the unity of the two organizations is enhanced. It's driving NATO and the EU together. It was not an accident last week when the EU announced its sanctions program that it was Ursula von der Leyen, the EU president, or the EC president, at NATO headquarters announcing those sanctions. So I actually think it's a good thing that they're paying more attention now and have more readiness, and I think NATO is well prepared now to work closely with the EU to ensure that it is a cooperative and not, something where we're tripping over each other, the two organizations, and really working at cross purposes. So I'm feeling good about it. On the red line question, for NATO, it's very basic. It is that incursion into NATO territory for any alliance during which the ally asks for Article 5 assistance. So, a Russian plane, maybe 10 Russian planes, somehow incursions over Baltic airspace. They are escorted out. They are sent back. They are sent away. It's when one of the Baltic states says, hey, this is turning into actually an incursion into my territory, into my airspace that is affecting my national security. That's when it gets to the point of the Article 5 commitment coming into play. So at the moment, and it's always something where the country has to ask, and then there has to be consensus around the table also as to whether it's time to respond. So I don't see any of that approaching at the moment, but it's going to be up to NATO, as I said earlier on, to work hard to ensure that any spillover from this invasion, this horrendous invasion of Ukraine, does not turn into a war of general nature in Europe. None of us wants to see World War III emerge out of this crisis.
Okay, do you want to close?
This is going to be a super rapid close. It's just a thank you to both of you. So these are succulents.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, good. I love succulents. They're the only thing that grow in my yard, so thank you.
So, in terms of the MIP suite, these are Jonathan Achter Memorial Succulents, because Jonathan loves succulents. Did you enjoy the design downstairs? It's really amazing. So Jonathan is the one who designed and monitored the construction. So we've established this in his name. So I just want to, we're closing out the fireside chat. Thank you so much. But remember, we do want to engage with a couple of alums. So I'd just like to thank you both for including. Now, we probably have another five or seven minutes. Did you notice there was not an end time for the fireside chat? And that is because this is such a vital, important topic that we just wanted to allow some flexibility. So I'm going to ask Chelsea and Dathan to come up, and we're going to take about 5 or so minutes to we'll get this going again. Now notice Dathan is not doing a very good job with his LinkedIn profile.
Come on up here, Dathan. That's what he looks like.
I know, there we go.
Perfect. Thanks, Eva.
I'm much more attractive in person.
Frank. Oh my goodness. Thank you so much to our panelists for speaking.
Okay, we can leave. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. So I wanted to ask for a show of hands who has had a good time tonight meeting other alums. Woo, yes, me too. Great. I'm Chelsea Furkey. I'm class of 2020. Really enjoying meeting a lot of people in person after graduating into the pandemic year. And Dathan, what year are you?
I am 2021.
Right. Recent grads. So I think Mava said it just right earlier about what a critical time this is. And I really enjoyed the conversations I had with so many of you all. And I think you did too, based on how long everyone stayed talking before moving into this room. And this is maybe a conversation that we would like to continue. So if you would like to continue it, Mava is going to set up some meetings in the spring quarter where we as a group get to decide how we want to use the platforms like FSI Connect and resources that MIP has for events like this to see how we want to increase our engagement. Dathan and I were talking earlier this week, and actually some ideas already came up. Dathan, do you want to kind of walk us through sure. what we talked about and what's here on the slide? There's some examples that we could discuss at these meetings.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Chelsea. Hey, so a few things. I'll start off by saying while tonight is a great night, I'm actually a little sad, and the reason I'm feeling a little sad is because I see multiple class members of mine that I've not had a chance to say hi to, and that crushes my soul just a little bit. I know, like, hey, right? But what I'm excited about is the fact that we'll have more opportunities to do this. I know, that's so cheesy, but I'm going with it. The fact is that there are so many of you that I have not had an opportunity to meet, and there are so many of my own classmates that I see here that the reception out there just wasn't enough time to catch up to everyone. And as a result of that, from a professional networking opportunity, there's FSI Connect, but also on a more personal level, we're looking at doing engagements with alumni, bringing back, having everyone come here, maybe doing regional chats. But the reason this year is we need to get a feel for engagement and how much people want to participate in such a thing. and where they're located that way were massing effect. The other thing we talked about were a few ideas of how we could get alumni engaged. How can we keep alumni engaged in the FSI brand, if nothing else to say about it? So one of the ideas that came up is looking at opening up the FSI blog to alumni. So currently the FSI blog is something that only current students can publish on, but if you're interested in getting engaged, and it gives you an opportunity to have something that you put out there that has the FSI name on it. So that's an opportunity. We also talked about looking at, you know, being a swag store. Maybe people want to purchase items and rep the colors while they're out to increase the reputation and the notice of the program. Because the reality is, everyone knows Sice, right? Everyone knows Hopkins. But increasing awareness of the MIP program is also super important. And as people become more aware of the program, it also makes people more aware of you. So we think that that's a great opportunity there. And that's the point of these conversations, is just to find out what other alumni are interested in, how would they like to be engaged in the Stanford community, how can the Stanford community better support alumni to keep them engaged and continue to provide a back and forth value between the two. And yeah, so look forward to the opportunity to engage with everyone on how we can create a joint relationship that is good for everyone.
Yeah, thanks, Nathan. If you're interested to learn more, be part of this conversation, you can email Mava, our email address up there on the screen. And we also might follow up with the dates whenever these meetings get set. I'll be there. I hope to see many of you there and be in touch. Thank you so much. And thanks, Mava, for this wonderful event for all in the MIP team.
All right, it is my pleasure to meet my best friend, Shirin.
Hi, everyone. Well, it's fallen to me to close what has been an absolutely wonderful event. So, I do want to say thank you to so many people who came together to make this event happen. Thank you to Frank, Rose, and Stephen for an enlightening and very informative and crucial conversation. Also want to say thank you and a really special thank you to Mava, who was the driving force behind this event. Thank you to the rest of the MIP team who, as always, came together and supported Mava in pulling this event together, Jonathan, Megan, Patrick, and Cheng. And there were several others behind the scenes. George, Mava's wonderful supportive husband. Oh. Yes. Lale, who is our international student advisor on the MIP team. And then to the FSI Central team, Debbie, Justin, Ari, Michelle, Rachel, they were part of this event in many ways as well. So I want to say thank you to all of them. And also thank you to all the alums who attended today. It's been wonderful to see all of you here. Many of you I've taught over the years. And you're still happy to see me, so that's wonderful. And also to the faculty who attended the event, the current students, thank you for making this such a wonderful, enriching experience today. I continue to hope that we will be able to meet in person in future years as well, and have these sorts of wonderful events. So on a positive note, we are not yet done. We have dessert out in the lobby. So that's, I think, a great way to end the evening. So thank you, and good night, everyone.